I welcome everyone. Thanks for coming and being part of this video conference. Thank you, everyone. Today's session, we are going to discuss about what do you mean by, what we actually mean by growth, success, ambition, future, all these terminologies. We are going to discuss this topic. How to motivate ourselves towards success. Usually, we have a lot of techniques how to organize ourselves, positive affirmations, so many techniques in the market that is available. And you will also be already aware of it. So we are not going to touch those general stuffs. What we are going to try today is, we are going to have an insight about what the very term goal means, what the very term success means, how the role of goal plays in our life, how it helps us, and how it hinders us. So this is going to be a different viewpoint of the same success technologies and goal technologies. So, just for 30 seconds, we will be in silence. We will watch our breath or just observe the things in front of us, or just feel that we are alive, the presence. So just for 30 seconds, just we'll be sitting in our own position and just be aware of our presence, our aliveness, our breath. Let us try for 30 seconds. Thank you for being silent. So this session is going to be a practical session. We are not interested in giving many concepts or building new ideologies. So we want people to actually realize in the practical life the benefits of our teachings. So let us start from goal. Usually, when something has been introduced into our society, we usually have some positive technologies, like it is very good. Everyone should follow. Everyone should follow at any cost, something like that. So we have taken the goal also like that, or success also like that. So when the idea of success has been introduced to society, it has been told that it is very good. One should achieve at any cost, or only aim should be success, or only aim should be reaching the goal, all those stuffs. Now, what slowly had happened is, people have started feeling that the negative side of running behind the goal, running behind the success, and they are slowly started feeling the negative effects of such an idea. We understand the importance of goal and success in our life, but everyone should have its place. So we should know where to keep success and goal in our hierarchy of values. Every goal has a functional element and a dysfunctional element. The functional element is, it gives us direction. For example, if I want to go to some market, or in future, after 2 years, how I should be. That's the idea about how I should be there. When I am there, what are the things I will be benefited? What are the things I will be enjoying? So this is the idea of goal. So it gives you a sense of direction. So in this time frame, in this direction, if I go, I'll be able to get those stuffs. So as long as a goal is giving a sense of direction, it is beautiful. So a goal as a functional element, that is, it gives a sense of direction. Now, the other side is, it has a dysfunctional element too. The dysfunctional element is, it is judgmental. Every goal is judgmental. What do we mean by judgmental? Is when we place a goal, it by nature it judges us that we are not raised up to this level. So we are only here. The gap is there. So we should not at the goal. We are not at the goal. So we are bad. So something like that, we compare with the goal and we put ourselves below. So when this happens for a day, for a month, for a year, what usually happens is we are condemned by the goal itself. This happens unconsciously, this happens unknowingly, and slowly we start evaluating ourselves at the height of goal. So actually the goal is there to motivate us, pull us. But after some time, what happens is the goal hinders us in moving towards the goal itself. So the very thing which we kept for our drive has started hindering the movement itself. So we have to see this functional element and dysfunctional element of the goal. The other things we should know is we are having goal or defining success as an individual. So what we slowly started is we have start admiring only the top 10 people in that field. For example, musical genre, or if you take even scientists, what we adore is, we started adoring only the top 10 of the department. So in this way, we can't operate. For example, a society should encourage everybody to live a satisfied and complete life. So if that is so, how we have to define the goal for the whole society? While I was walking in the evening a few months before, I saw a person, a mechanic working in the shop. So suddenly a thought came, So what would be the ideal goal for this mechanic to live a fulfilled life? So we can't ask that person to become a IT professional and to work in US, and working in US is the highest goal. It is not possible. But if you give, but we are giving a, such a goal to everybody, which is unattainable, and he will be blaming himself for that non-attaining the goal. So the goal should be enriching oneself and completing one's own life. So if that is the case, how we are going to define the goal? How we are going to define the success for everybody? If you look deeply, what usually we are missing is something, the fulfillment or the peace or any state that I will be complete. All the psychological states will be attained only in the future. So first you have to understand what is future. Future is a place where we can cognitively think about it and ask others to think about it, and we all can get the fruit of the any action in the future. So let us take an example. So if I am driving in the car, usually what happens is I see the GPS where the roads, the presentation is in the GPS. So I make use of this GPS to navigate in the real world. So same is the way the GPS, the representation model is what is in our head. It is in the our cognitive thinking. So in this cognitive thinking, we try to assess different physical, food, security, everything. These are the basic requirements of human beings. So these basic requirements of human beings, we need to get. So for that, we have a map, idea, or concepts. So we can get all those stuffs in the future. So the GPS or the conceptual thinking, cognitive thinking helps us to get the physical objects. The cognitive thinking is used only to get the physical objects. For that, we are using this thinking. This we should understand very important. See, I want an apple. So I eat now. So I want the apple or food in the near future too. So I go and plant it and I harvest it and I reap this fruit from that tree. So that is in near future. So I think about how many days it will take, how many people has to work for that, watering the tree, all those stuff. So these stuffs I do in order to get a physical food, physical object. But I conceptually think how many people has to work, how many hours they have to work, how much I have to pay. All these things happen psychologically in order to get a physical object. As far as this cognitive thinking goes, to attain the physical object, that's fine. So now, what's the problem of the humanity is, now this cognitive function has a dysfunctional element too. Let us see that. What is the dysfunctional element of the cognitive thinking? We saw that when we use cognitive thinking for the physical object, it's not a problem. Now, what we started having is psychological goals or psychological accomplishments. As far as the physical accomplishments there, I can get food, security, all those stuffs, basic requirements of human being, or physical accomplishments. So physical accomplishments is fine. What is psychological accomplishment is? I want to be in a peaceful state. So we are. I want to feel fulfilled. I want to feel complete. I want to feel at home. So these are the psychological accomplishments. So these accomplishments cannot be attained through thinking. But what we started doing is, as we are able to get physical objects, physical requirements, necessities through cognitive thinking, we also started thinking that these psychological states, peace, joy, fulfillment, all those stuffs can be attained through thinking. So this is the major flaw that happens in the cognitive thinking. As far as it goes to physical, real, material, objective goals, it is fine. So, but if you make goal for even psychological matters like peace, joy, all those stuffs, that becomes a problem. So, that cannot be attained through our cognitive thinking. And it's our very nature. Our very nature is, in a sense, peace, completeness. So from that, from our base only we operate and we come out and think and get physical object. So as we leave our cognitive thinking effort, we are already in our home or our peaceful state. Whatever positive psychological states we are striving for, we are trying to attain, that is already there. Only we are able to recognize that we are already having it. So once that goal is already there, if we know that, then the physical goal becomes easy. And there is no need to train people how to get physical goals accomplished, because we are already well trained, well equipped in those physical matters. So only we have to know how to attain the goals of the psychological states. And this is, once this is done, the physical accomplishments, physical efforts becomes easy. Because one department we have already closed. The goals of the psychological world has been attained. And once that has been attained, we become peaceful. Right now, what happens? All our actions is something like dent filling. That is, I have some dents in my psychological being. I feel incomplete, I feel unfulfilled, I feel that only if I go to the top position I will be okay, now I am not okay. This we can call just dent. There is some dent in our psychological being. So in order to fill this dent, we try to put physical objects. I buy a very big car, I want to become a very big position. So all these accomplishments, we don't want to do it for physical purpose. We are trying to do it for our psychological accomplishments. So we are trying to fill some dent that is in our psychological structure, and it will not be fulfilled at any physical objects accomplishments. So how we operate is, if I become powerful, if I become successful, if I become big, if I become famous, I will be fulfilled. So this is what at the base of our longing. even though I reach that throne, I will not be fulfilled. Still, I will feel the dent and I will feel the unfulfillment. Rather, how we should operate is, the fulfillment is already here and we need to understand this source that we are already fulfilled. And if I go to the throne, I will be decorating the throne, I will be adding value to the throne, I will be adding value to that position. Rather, the throne or the chair or position adding value to me. So if that is the case, then we will be always trying to get fulfilled. Our only purpose will be trying to use these physical accomplishments, physical success, even people will try to fulfill the psychological dent. So naturally, every person will resist. Why they should become a thing for me to get fulfilled? Naturally, they will resist. And they have their own dents. So everybody will resist. So if you keep success as a measure for fulfilling your psychological dents, naturally everybody will resist. So the psychological dent has to be fulfilled by only psychological aspect. It can't be fulfilled by the physical accomplishments. Shini, if you can play the video, then we can go for another discussion. That's a short video that everyone can watch. That will be related to our subject.
Sure, thank you.
Society tells us the way to be happy is to achieve our goals. Get that great job, earn that money, get a good body, find a partner, have happy, healthy kids, have a big house, have a nice car, have holidays. Goal, 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 goal. And it's true that if you do actually manage to achieve these goals, then there is a little moment of joy and happiness. But how long does it last? How long before you're looking at the next goal, and then the next goal, and then the next goal? And as we live our life trying to constantly strive to achieve these goals, one after the other after the other, how tiring and exhausting does it get? Is this you? There is a radically different way to live your life, which is a life based on values, a values-focused life. It's like two kids in the back of a car, and it's a three-hour car journey to Disneyland. And the first kid is totally goal-focused. Are we there yet? Are we there yet? How much longer? Are we there yet? This journey of frustration, it's all about the goal. The second kid is values focused. He's got the same goal. He wants to get to Disneyland, but he's also in touch with his values around curiosity, adventure, having fun. So he's looking out of the window, playing I Spy with My Little Eye. He's counting all the, the interesting farmhouses that he sees on the way. He's spotting interesting farm animals, cows and sheep. He's noticing different types of trucks and cars on the freeway. So he's actually appreciating the journey as he heads towards his goal. Now, they both reach Disneyland at the same time. They both have a fantastic time at Disneyland because they both got to achieve the goal. But the first kid had a journey of frustration. The second kid had a fulfilling, rewarding journey. Then on the way home, the first kid, are we home yet? Are we home yet? Are we home yet? All about the goal, all that frustration. Second kid's looking out of the window, noticing how the world looks different at night, spotting the lights in the farmhouses and the cat's eyes on the freeway. The car breaks down on the way to Disneyland. Now, both kids are really disappointed because neither of them achieved their goal. But the second kid at least had a fulfilling journey up until that point. Now, when the pickup truck arrives to tow them home, the first kid, "Oh, it's not fair! I want to go to Disneyland! How long before the car gets repaired? It's not fair! It's not fair!" The second kid starts to notice how the world looks different when you're sitting in the front of a pickup truck high above the level of the rest of the traffic. So this is the very important distinction between the values-focused life and the goal-focused life. In the values-focused life, we have the fulfillment and satisfaction of living our values every step of the way towards our goals, the satisfaction of achieving our goals, and the fulfillment that comes of living our values even when we don't achieve our goals.
I hope we are able to hear the audio now. So, what one this is doing? Practically see what we call this innocent state, or what we call this peaceful state, or our home, is right within us, is within our capacity of the brain itself. For example, when I feel, just like today morning I'm getting up, and just if I'm sitting, 8 o'clock I get up, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, I'll be feeling peaceful. At 10 o'clock, what happens is, this peaceful state, I get hunger. So what I become restless. So the purpose of restlessness is, when hunger comes, the hunger has to be fulfilled. So it makes me restless to get this food. So I get up and eat something, and again I become peaceful. So what we need to understand here is, our natural state is peaceful when some requirements have to be fulfilled. The very life creates a restlessness, hunger, uneasiness to fulfill the requirement. So I get, it gives me energy, pushes me and goes and attains something. And once I attain the physical requirement, fulfill the physical requirement, I naturally restore peace. So usually in brain physiology, this frontal portion of the brain is cognitive thinking function. So the remaining non-cortex, the above is cortex, below is non-cortex. So this cortex part of the brain is a thinking brain which is there to fulfill our requirements. So once we leave, once that is done, automatically we fall into this non-cortex part of the brain, where it is our naturally peaceful, innocent state. So it is only posting of just how to come 2 inches below. So our own psychological goals, psychological states is just inside our skull, inside our brain. For that we not go anywhere else. Everyone is blessed with here within their own skull. So once we understand, we will not be trying to accomplish this heaven outside, in the outside world. Of course, there are few things we need to go for outside the world, for food, for regulating temperature, safety, for our offsprings, So all these natural requirements, we need to go for the physical world and get back. Once we get that physical object, we automatically fall into our peaceful state. So trying to attain any peaceful state or trying to be fulfilling in the physical world will utterly fail, because we can't get fulfillment from the external world. Because it's our own nature, it's our own state, basic natural state. From there only we operate. From there we become tense and get something and come back and respond. So this is how it operates. Okay, then the question is, why we misunderstand? Why we don't understand this logic? See, usually what happens is, while the development is, we start associating, let's say association, there's some concept of association. So we associate things with the emotional states. Example, if I become restless. So what I think is, I have to go on food. Once I have food, my restlessness subsides. So what I think is, if I eat food, I will become peaceful. So food is peaceful. So we associate the physical object with the emotional state. Let us try to understand this. Food is very easy requirement. It's not complicated like other requirements. So let us, if once we understand this, we have thought about the whole problem of this cognitive thinking. For example, from 8 o'clock to 10 o'clock, I am very peaceful. At 10 o'clock, I am getting hunger. Then I become restless. Then I eat food. Once I eat food, I am again becoming peaceful as I am at 8 o'clock. So what I associate is, so the food I ate only gave this state, peaceful state. So I should eat more. I should consume more, I should gather more food, more wealth, more things, more people. So this is what the association theory. So first we associate it wrongly and equate food and peaceful state. Food cannot bring peaceful state. So, but if you understand this, how we associated this thing, and we can, if you see the peaceful state is our own nature, then we can go automatically whenever we want, whenever we need peace, we can just like that, we can go into our peaceful state and be there. And for this, we don't need any physical effort, physical people, or physical places, or physical situation should happen. This is our own birthright, our own paradise, our own heaven. So, there are only a few things to be discussed. I think if we have some question answers now, we can engage into question answers. So, Srinivas,
you can
ask for them.
Sure, thanks. Thanks, Chandrasekhar. So, now it's a Q&A time. If you wish to ask questions, you can actually unmute yourself and ask questions. Alternatively, you can also type on the stage, type the question in the window, chat window, and I can read out and Chandrasekhar can answer. So we're waiting for questions. While we're waiting for questions, so one question that I want to ask Mr. Shekhar. Mr. Shekhar, so...
Can I go ahead and discuss a few more things?
Yeah, sure.
So what we saw here, we need to understand that our peaceful state, our home is already there. Once we know that, without effort, we can just jump into it, or we can say in it, whatever, or whenever we need it. It will be difficult to believe because that is just within our brain is functionality. What we are searching outside is just within the ability of our own brain function. For example, if thousands of years before, if somebody had said that this charcoal, that black piece, has a lot of energy, it can even help in transportation, nobody would have believed, because everybody knows charcoal and they would have seen a black small piece of carbon, charcoal. So this small, how to derive energy from the charcoal, and we can run engines and we can transport all those just within this charcoal. If you see this charcoal as just a piece of object, then it's very difficult to conceive the energy within it and how that energy can be used for transportation, running engines and running industries. It's very difficult. So similarly the case now, really the very thing, the very nature, all the psychological goals are right within ourselves. But it's very difficult to conceive. Because we think we know our brain, we think we know ourselves, we think how heaven can be said in myself. If it is said, why am I not able to know? So it is not there. So all these confusion questions initially happens. So, but if you have passions and just some insight, and just used to juggle with these ideas, and you can easily find the heaven and the home within your skull, within your brain, within your mind. So another way of
Chandrasekhar, sorry, there is a question. So can we take the question now?
Let me finish this and I will be completing. And then
Sure.
So another way of looking the same thing is, as soon as this cognitive function develops in our childhood, say after 13 years, we start associating all the forms and we form an identity with the form. For example, if I'm playing very, very good cricket, I think I'm a good cricketer. If I am able to get some degree and get some job, I associate myself with that position. If I acquire some more wealth, I associate that position with myself. I have ability to speak, I have ability to think intellectually, and you associate that identity, I am an intellect. So all this identity are forms. And this form identity is very useful and very as a utilitarian function in the society. Without this form identity, we cannot operate in the world. So this form identity is a must, and we should enhance this form identity. This form acquisition or form make me form as a goal is a part and necessary of the human life. At the same time, we should also know that this formlessness by very nature this innocent state is a formless state, and that's what takes the forms and becomes a CA in one person, the boss makes cricketer in some other person. And this formlessness takes the form and acquires something in the world and makes an identity of that form. So we should be aware of our form identity, and also we should be aware of this formlessness identity. Right now, we have become well versed in knowing or in gaining or acquiring in the world of forms. So it is good, but we also have to know this formless identity. Every human being, by nature, we are this formlessness. We are at the state of innocence, peaceful. So once we have both identity, we will be peaceful and as well as successful in the outside world. So in the inner world, we will have our own nature, our innocence, our peaceful state, and we will have the success and the wealth and the accomplishments that we are attaining in the external world. So in the form of identity, we can also get form identity as well as formless identity. So this formless identity, what we are focusing today. What is this formless identity? What is this form? What is this? What all this psychological world? These are the things we are discussing, and we are able. This is a simple idea, but an effective idea. So I wish everyone can ponder over it and ask questions if you have any. Thank you.
So, Chandrasekhar, so before you close, I think there's a question. So the question is, how to reach or achieve peace and peace, joy and love from within inside without depending on outside world? Okay, and there is also a subsequent point. Even if we want to disassociate with physical or outside world, or people don't allow you to live with peace, how do you deal with this outside world? Maybe a second question. You can answer the first question. How to reach or achieve peace, joy, and love within inside without depending on outside world?
The question is, how to achieve peace and joy that is within ourselves without depending upon the external object of contribution. So the very understanding will take you to your home, to the peaceful state. What we need to understand is, as far as 12 or 13 age, we are innocent and we are joyful. So every child is joyful or peaceful in its nature. Even though it gets angry, it forgets about it and becomes normal and flowing and dynamic. So at the age of 13, what happens is the intellect bonds. So once intellect is born, intellect is very efficiently dealing with all these physical stuff. How to clean myself, how to get job, how to talk to others, how to get rank, how to get a job, how to build a bridge, how to build a tower. All these stuff is perfectly managed, the intellect. So what it thinks is, so if I am able to do all these steps, so it thinks I can also get peace. It thinks I can also get joy. So it tries to attain peace and joy as if some physical accomplishment. So the intellect has to understand that the very trying we make it not to attain. Because the very cognitive thinking is a tension. Because you have to focus on something and work out on something to get something. So the very process is tension. So if you try to become tense to get peace, it will not work. So what intellect has to understand is, if it does not try to attain anything, it will fall back to its natural state, which is a peaceful state, which is its home. So if you want anything, you can become tense and get something and forget about it. So this is the process. We are at peace by nature. When something we want, naturally we become tense and try to get something, work out for something and get that object and come back to our physical state. So we have to understand peace and joy is our natural state. If you try to attain it, the very question is how to attain peace. We can't attain peace, but you can be peaceful. That's the same thing. If you try to attain, you can't get it an object. Because you will be tense together to receive the peace. So once you know that our very nature is peacefulness, joyfulness, you just get back. Once you get back, you are peaceful, we are joyful by our own nature. We are at home. When something is needed, we can come out and work. Otherwise, we will be at home.
Thanks. So the related question is, if we want to disassociate with the physical or outside world, the outside world are people who don't allow you to live in peace. How do you deal with this?
I'm not able to hear
the problem.
Your voice.
Let me repeat. So the question is, even if you want to disassociate with the physical or outside world, the outside world or people don't allow you to live in peace. How to deal with this also?
Can you repeat once again?
Sorry. So the question is, if you want to disassociate with the physical or outside world, the outside world don't allow you to live in peace. How to deal with this?
Got it. So the question is, I want to be peaceful, but the outside world is not allowing me to be peaceful. How to deal with it? It's a good question. So I want to be peaceful, so that's what everybody wants, and the outside world is not allowing me to be peaceful. The very thing we need to understand is, the outside world is in itself tension. In outside world, we cannot be peaceful. In this sense, what is outside world? I come to market, then everybody comes to the market, and everybody comes to the market, and we are there to take as much as we want, and everybody is like that. So naturally, there will be conflict and fight. So the very transaction of the outside world is in conflict. So there you can't be peaceful. There is no way to be peaceful in the outside world transaction. So it will be tensions. It will be in conflict. It will be energy draining only. So the very outside dealing is a draining. So only the inside world is energy regenerating stuff. So if you try to find peace, if you try to find non-conflict, non-draining transactions, activities in the world, I think it's not possible at all. So the only way to get peace is to go to your inner world. And it doesn't mean that if there is conflict, we have to come back. We have to understand that the very way of dealing, the very way of transaction is conflict. And we have to move in conflict too. We have to confront the conflict and deal with it and get the physical objects, physical accomplishments and come back. So we are going for the outside world only for the physical accomplishments, not for the psychological accomplishments. Because all psychological accomplishments, we have to go inside. If you try to get psychological accomplishments outside, we will utterly fail. Because outside world is only for physical things. physical food, security, people, all those stuff. You can't get peace, joy, some good stuff like that in the outside world.
Thank you. I hope that answers. Next question is how to experientially know the peace. In other words, how to experience peace. Though I understand the peace is my nature.
Although I understand
that the peace is my nature.
Or peace is my nature.
Yeah. So how do we, you know, how do we know that, you know, we have peace.
The question is, even though the peace is my nature, why am I not able to feel it? Why am I not able to?
So, how do we experience? How do we know that, you know, I'm experiencing, I have peace?
As I said before, you just watch yourself. Whenever you are sitting quietly, peacefully, or when there is no tension, or when there is no thing to do, your very nature is peaceful. Once something is comes from the cognitive thinking, I need to accomplish that, or I need to do that, or even I need to be peaceful. Even that is an accomplishment. So any project you give this to this cognitive thinking. So the cognitive thinking is to do some action. It thinks, it plans, it tries conceptually how to execute and how to attain all those things. So any project, if you, for example, few team members sitting in the conference room. And when team leader enters and he's having a fight, naturally team member will start seeing the team lead and seeing the fight, and we automatically will feel energy or to execute that project. So same wise, the cognitive thinking, you bring any project to that, it will start working. So you can work for food, you can work for shelter, you can work for future, all those steps. But if you want to work for peace, it sees peace also a project having identified. So anything you bring to the cognitive thinking, it will automatically start restless, agitative, and start working towards that goal. So if you really want peace or joy or any psychological steps, the non-doing is better. The non-doing can happen only if you can understand that it is our own nature. Any doing for that will produce only tension. If you understand this portfolio, for example, if you understand your body, how it operates, we can handle it properly. Same way, we have to understand this mind portfolio. So this mind portfolio does not work like a physical linear approach. Here, yes, some little twist is there. That's why it's very difficult to understand this. If you want some bridge, or if you want some 23 floor building, the mind is capable of doing that. But it can't bring peace even for a short period of time. Why? Because any doing it can do, but non-doing, the cognitive thinking is not capable of that. We need to understand that. Once we understand that, we automatically fall into peace. We don't do or we don't attain peace. We automatically fall into peace, and when work is clear, we come out and do our work. Hope this answers to your question. Thank you.
The next question is, could you please ask, will we say that the peace is easiness within one? So, whoever has asked this question, would you like if you want to correctly rephrase it? But I'm just asking for the Shekhar. Will we say that the peace is easiness within one? So, do you understand the Shekhar?
Yeah, the question is, we can relate the term peace and easiness as one. Yes, you can eat bread. So, the word or the label is not more important. You can use any words, but you have to feel that warm or your ease or what ease or you are comfortable with it, whatever, or there is no conflict. So any technologies you can use, but the problem, but the important thing is you have to feel it and you have to be in that state. You can define the state in different ways as you want. That's not a problem.
Okay, that's a follow-up question. Are we saying that any thinking is stressful? In other words, are we saying that any job is stressful?
The question is thinking stressful? Is any job stressful?
Yeah.
So technically, if you understand what is thinking, for example, I am sitting in this room and there is no danger or no harm is going to come to me. I am comfortable sitting here for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. When I hear some sound or some noise, huge noise at the door or somebody is breaking sound, then I become curious. What is that sound? What might be there? It is a thief or some neighbors or some boys. So the very thinking happens to sort out the unknown. See, as for us, we are in the known. There is no need to think in the known because everything happens. This is my hall, that is kitchen. Everybody in my house I know and I know how they behave and everything is fine. When I am known, there is no need for thinking. When something unknown comes inside, I need to think because I need to sort out this unknown. So I have to figure it out because it is a dangerous thing. It might be a dangerous thing. So the very purpose of thinking is to deal with the unknown. So that process will be truly stressful by its nature and depends upon the severity of the unknown and severity of the danger, all those things. So if it is a small sound in the morning, it will be fine. If the same sound happens in the night, then it's a different thing. So it depends upon the situation. When your manager gives some warning during normal days, it's different. When the manager gives some warning during the layoff period, that's a different tone. So there the thinking will be different, here the thinking will be different. So the CID will be varying across, but generally, technically, any thinking is a effort to solve the unknown. So by nature, it will be consensual. Thank you.
And any questions? Any questions? If there are no questions, so I'm going to just stop the recording.